The movie opens in a new world where God is a human-like entity with feelings, desires, and emotions. He lives in an apartment in Brussels which he shares with his wife and his 10-year-old daughter Aya. His older son JC was a rebel who wanted to do things his way, hence, God doesn't like talking about him. Unlike how he is normally painted, this God is not a messiah or the savior. He is simply a creator who is bored of designing things. Before creating humans, he made cities and towns filled with only animals. But such a world was boring since animals didn't create drama on their own. Hence, God made the first human in his skin named Adam. After traveling the world, he found a woman named Eve and instantly fell in love. Being the first humans was a bit difficult for the couple at first. But after trying a bunch of things in bed, they finally managed to get Eve pregnant. Their children multiplied over the years and eventually, humankind was formed. God watches them learn and grow, but it all gets boring after a while. As time passes, he turns sadistic, someone who gets high by making people suffer. He creates stupid rules like a slice of bread will always fall to the ground with the jam side down and the line next to you in grocery stores will always move quicker. When the little problems get old, he creates bigger ones like terrorism, global warming, poverty, natural calamities, and so on. Even outside of work, God is a terrible creature, always bossing his wife around and treating her like a lesser being. He is emotionally and physically abusive to his daughter as well. She can move things with her mind like her older brother JC, but God doesn't allow her to use her powers, jealous that he doesn't have them. No one is allowed into his office room where he keeps files and data about humankind. Until one day, Aya finds the door open and walks inside without her father's knowledge. In the middle of the room is a computer that God uses to control the entire world. Through the computer, Aya discovers the many catastrophes that her father has created. She is disgusted at how he enjoys watching people drown in misery. Hence, at dinner that night, she calls him out for being a sadist. An enraged God whips her with his belt for hours until his anger dies down. By the end of the toter, Aya has had enough. She decides to run away from home, but since it has no doors or windows, she asks her brother for help. When she touches a little statue in her room, it comes to life as JC and explains what she must do next. She should first get herself a bunch of apostles, someone who can be an advocate for her policies and ideas. JC tried 12 and it was too messy, so he asks her to try getting only 6 apostles. To choose the said apostles, she can just randomly pick up 6 human cards from her father's study. Then, JC asks her to write a brand new testament using the apostles and their experiences. That way, Aya can contribute to the betterment of humanity like JC once did. To get her out of the house, he has hacked the dryer and connected it to the human world. After a long chat, Aya steals the key to the study room from her father and retrieves 6 human cards randomly. Before leaving, she hacks into his computer and sends a text to every living human, telling them the exact day they are about to die. This brings chaos to the human world. Many people who have less time on Earth, leave their jobs and start doing things they always wanted to. Some eat whatever they like while the others take a step further and jump off buildings. Initially, people don't believe the text messages, but many coincidences happen in relation to the texts, making them come to terms with their death date. The scared ones do everything they can to prevent their deaths, but they ultimately find out that it is inevitable, as they can die from simple accidents like a cupboard falling on them. This also sends people into a moral dilemma, and many soldiers flee the war, wanting to do better with the time they have left. As the chaos continues, Aya goes into the dryer and crawls along a long path until she finally reaches the human world. She enjoys the rain for some time before eating a burger from the dumpster. When the burger makes her sick, she is helped by a homeless man named Victor. She senses that he is a good man and asks him to help her write the testament since she is not good at writing herself. Initially, Victor dismisses her request as childish, but when she continues following him, he agrees to help. Back at home, God wakes up and finds out that the world he created is changing into a better place. Until now, the uncertain future made people fear doing what they loved. But with their lifetime in front of them, they can choose whatever they want to do with their lives. This brings people joy, which is against God's wish of how humans should be. He quickly goes to his computer to change the settings but finds out that it has been hacked. Aya's smell is lingering around the house, and by following it, he finds the pathway located in the dryer. At this moment, he decides to go into the world he created to teach his daughter a lesson. Back on Earth, Victor and Aya go to their first apostle named Orly. She is a beautiful woman, wanted by many men and envied by every woman she meets. However, she is always sad and frequently blames her life for being unfair. It turns out that when she was a teen, Orly lost her left arm and has been wearing prosthetics since then. Aya asks her to talk about her life so they can extract the important parts to write in the New Testament. Victor gets ready with a pen and a piece of paper to note down Orly's life lessons. She starts by saying that the most crucial moment of her life was not when she lost her arm, it was when she met a homeless man one day. He told her that life is like a skating rink where a lot of people fall. It was a simple sentence that many people would interpret in the ways they like. However, to Orly, the sentence gave her life a new meaning. She knows she has already had her fall and is trying to get up for several years. Aya understands her concerns and asks her to wait for a miracle that is about to happen shortly. At night, Orly dreams of reuniting with her hand. She comes to terms with her disability and finally gets up from the skating rink that the homeless man told her about. After Orly, Aya moves on to the second apostle, Jean. In his childhood, Jean loved adventures and always wanted to explore the world. But when reality hit, he got stuck in a 9-to-5 job, dedicating his life to climbing the corporate ladder. When he found out that he has 12 years left to live, he didn't want to work anymore. Hence, he sat down on a park bench and hasn't moved ever since. He spends his day looking at things around him and feeding birds. Aya finds him on the same park bench and sits down to chat. She can talk to animals and offers to translate Jean's words to a bird. Jean wants to ask the bird why it never flies away from the park when it has wings to travel anywhere in the world. In turn, the bird asks Jean the same question. The question brings clarity to Jean's mind and he sets off on a journey to find himself. At the same time, God finally reaches the other end of the tunnel and enters the human world. He is instantly troubled by the world he programmed when a lady pepper sprays him for being a creep. As he tries eating a burger from the garbage can, he is attacked by the street gangs. Later, he is taken to the hospital where he gets into a fight with the doctor after insulting him. Still not coming to terms with a human's way of life, he steals a kid's sandwich and is beaten by the mother. Meanwhile, Aya looks for the third apostle named Mark. He is a sex addict whose only wish in life is to get in bed with as many women as possible. His addiction started when he saw a girl on the beach at the start of his teenage years. After finding out he has around 80 days to live, he took all the money out of the bank and has been spending it on prostitutes every night. However, it hasn't provided him with ultimate happiness and he is still longing for something deeper. Aya tells him that he has a beautiful voice and asks him to do something with it. She is sure that the path will lead him to happiness. The next day, Mark gets the job as a voice actor and meets a woman at work. She turns out to be the same girl who he saw at the beach a long time ago. They two instantly feel the chemistry between them and go back to his place. For the first time in Mark's life, he feels a connection deeper than his sexual urges and they fall asleep holding hands. In the meantime, God's wife is enjoying time alone without her husband. While cleaning the house, she notices that three more apostles have been added to the picture of the Last Supper. Somewhere else, God ends up in a church thinking that it is the one place he will be respected. But he is beaten for cutting a line to the food. The pastor helps him and feeds him, but God repays the kindness by insulting the man and making fun of his life. Even the calm pastor loses his cool and abuses him. Meanwhile, Aya and Victor make their way to the next apostle named Francois. For the last week, he has turned into an assassin after finding out that he has 25 years left to live. He thinks that he is not doing anything wrong by killing people since the ones who die at his hands were supposed to die anyway. One day, he is on a mission when Aya approaches him, asking him to target a specific lady. The lady turns out to be Orly, hence when the bullet hits her prosthetic arm, Francois thinks it is a miracle that she doesn't die. Intrigued, he follows her for the rest of the day and is smitten by her beauty. He falls in love but keeps on denying it to himself, until one day when he buys Orly flowers. Gathering much courage, Francois hands them to her, expressing his love. Orly accepts them but gives him no reply. Then, Aya visits the fifth apostle Martine. She used to be a hopeless romantic who is now stuck in a loveless marriage. She found out that her husband is going to outlive her for 30 years and has been sulking ever since. She even tries hooking up with random men to get rid of her loneliness, but nothing works. Aya meets her and senses that she is being called by someone in the circus. Martine takes her word and the three go to a circus later that day. There, Martine locks eyes with a gorilla and instantly feels a connection to it. Knowing that he is her one chance at happiness, she buys the animal from the circus. At night, they connect and Martine ends up kissing him. Somewhere else, Orly calls Francois and the two decide to meet. Orly shows him her prosthetic arm, and he kisses it, showing that he loves every part of her. They make love and Francois finally finds happiness outside of killing people. The following morning, God is wandering down a street when he sees Aya and Victor. He chases them behind, but they manage to escape by walking on the water. When God tries to do it, he almost drowns and loses the other two. A group of men from the church save him and bring him back to the pastor, but even he doesn't want to take care of the guy. After that, Aya finds her last apostle, a boy named Willie who is about to die from a terminal illness. His last wish in life is to dress as a girl and his parents allow him to do so. Aya makes friends with him and gives him a shining fish as a gift. Before dying, Willie wants to send the fish to the sea. On Monday, he sells all of his parents' furniture to travel to a beach that he always wanted to visit. On Tuesday, Francois tells Orly that he is in love with her and wants to spend the rest of his life with her. Wednesday is the day when Martine's husband finds her in bed with the gorilla. They kick him out of the house and continue their romantic relationship. Then, Thursday comes and Mark makes love to his girlfriend for the first time. On Friday, Jean follows a flock of birds and reaches a place in the Arctic. There, the birds signal him to a woman who happens to be his soulmate. And, on the last day of the week, God is deported to Uzbekistan with a group of illegal immigrants. At the same time, Willie and the others come to the beach where he sets the fish free. He is only a few minutes away from dying, so the group decides to stay on the beach until his last breath. In the meantime, God's wife enters his office to clean it. She unplugs the computer, which sends the entire world into a frenzy. The airplane that God is in starts to descend towards the beach, threatening to kill everyone. Thankfully, she plugs the computer again just in time to avoid the crash. She then proceeds to make personalized changes in the world, giving every human the gift of immortal life. The sky is covered with flowers, people can walk underwater with their pet fishes, the rules of gravity can be bent, and the world turns into a utopia where all dreams are fulfilled and everything is possible. Martine has a human baby with the gorilla, Victor publishes the New Testament and becomes a renowned author, Francois is pregnant with Orly's child, and lastly, Aya and Willie kiss each other. The only character who doesn't have a happy ending is God, who is stuck in Uzbekistan without a family. He desperately spends the rest of his days looking into every dryer for a way to return home.